Hi. In this video, we're going to be starting with the first unit of econometrics, which is essentially the nature and the scope of the subject. So nature and scope. Now here I would like to talk about, I'd like to talk about two things. Number one is that, I would like to kind of give you an introduction to what the subject is and what it is doing. And the second thing that I will be doing is example, which would talk about, the first kind of econometric equation and, present that. So that's about it for this unit. That's it, right? So to talk about the introduction, the first thing that, I think I started this in the statistics course as well, and here also. So it's essentially that, so in this arena, you have a population, right? In econometrics, just like, in statistics, you had a population that you wanted to understand, and hence you would take a sample from it and, make predictions about the sample. So in statistics, you kind of go from, what is it that is happening with this population, and how can I describe it? Right. So in like I said, in statistics, you had a population, you would take multiple samples to understand this population. And you would make inferences. So you would make predictions on, the nature of this. So you would make estimates of, parameters of the population, mu and sigma squared. After you made these estimates, you would make predictions of, values that would fall in the population versus values that wouldn't, etc., etc. So the point is that, here you would answer what is it that is going on with the population, and how can I describe it? So how to describe the population, and what is it that the population actually looks like, right? So what would be answered by these, and how can you describe it would, be given by the distribution itself. So would it be normal? Would it be, something else, and so on and so forth. So in statistics, you would want to answer these questions. In econometrics, you kind of you go about this in a slightly different way. You still have a population, you would still like to answer the questions, but the population itself is coming because of the fact that you have something that you would like to test. So there is a theory, in econometrics, as the word suggests, it's the measurement of economics. So economics and metrics would kind of make up the words together, right? So here there is an economic theory, very importantly, right? And an economic theory would give you a hypothesis, something called a hypothesis. Based on the fact that you want to test this hypothesis, you would define your population, take samples, get data, do all of these things. You would have, essentially a distribution on this population that you would assume, and then from there you would come to defining a model, and from this model you would like to test your hypothesis. Okay, so here the things that you're doing are kind of in contrast, right? So in statistics, you wanted to describe this population, that's where you would end, right? So you would model how the population is looking like. You model the distribution of the population. In econometrics, you are going a step further. You are saying, okay, given that this is the model of the population, I would like to understand, I would like to model again. I'm using the word in both senses, because of the fact that in statistics it means modeling the distribution, in econometrics it means modeling the economic theory, so that you can test your hypothesis. When I say modeling the economic theory, I mean you will develop an equation. That's it, right? You get an equation to test your hypothesis. How you build that equation, what is it that you do in it, those are things that I will come to in some time. But the idea here is that, given that you have economic theory behind you, you would develop a hypothesis. Based on that hypothesis, you would have a population defined, and from that population, you would take some assumptions on the distributions of that population, you would develop a model, and you would test your hypothesis. So that's the basic idea. Let me give you a small example. So let's say you have the theory of demand in economics, right? And let's say you wanted to study the demand for sugar. So I have quantity demanded for sugar, right? So now logically speaking, You know, since we in econometrics we talk about equations, so a general form of an equation is y is equal to alpha plus beta x, right? So there is y, and there is a constant, and then there is a intercept. So I mean, there's an intercept, and then there is a slope, and then there is x. So y is equal to alpha plus beta x can be a general form of equation. I could also write this as y is equal to mx plus c, right? This is more, this may be more familiar to you. This is just the way, you know, I would like to talk about it for this course to come. So or I could write it also as y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1x. You will see a lot of, you know, these different forms in your books, and that's okay, right? Whatever it is, the point is that, you know, it talks about the same equation. We're talking about an equation. Now let's say this y I define as quantity demanded for sugar. The first thing to understand is that, you know, y is the dependent variable here. So y is the variable that you would like to explain, so to say, and x's are your explanatory variables, right? So since we're talking about the quantity demanded for sugar, what is the quantity demanded for any good depend upon? Economic theory tells you that quantity demanded is going to be a function of, you know, own price of substitutes, price of complements, and income at the very least, right? You know that quantity demand is going to be a function of at least these P1, P2, M, right? So quantity demanded for sugar could be a function of, you know, sugar's price of, you know, something which is a substitute, which is something like, you know, jaggery, price of, you know, something like sucrose, which is again a substitute, and then price of a complement, for example tea, and, you know, income, right? So quantity demand for sugar would depend on all these things. So I could write an equation for sugar which would look something like beta naught plus beta 1, you know, sugar price, and then plus beta 2 price of, let's say, jaggery, and, you know, beta 3 income, and so on, right? So this is just, you know, I've just added more variables to the equation. That's all I've done. In a mathematical setting, this would be saying, okay, a plus b x1 plus, so b1 x1 plus b2 x2, and so on, right? But, you know, think about it logically. Can you list out all the substitutes for sugar, or all the substitutes for all the complements for sugar that there are? Maybe you could list them out. Even more importantly, could you get data on them, right? Because understand that the entire point of econometrics is to be able to test economic theory on empirical data, right? So you go from, you know, having a theory which you look at, to actually coming to the point where you're able to test that theory. Now, to be able to test any theory, you need the data for this, right? To be able to test in econometrics, at least. So you need data for all of these things. Can you, you know, confidently calculate, collect data for everything, number one? Or, you know, would you always be in a situation where, you know, there would be something that you wouldn't be able to explain? Chalo, quantity demanded ke liye aapko shayad ho sakta hai, lag bhi raha ho ki aap sara data ikhatta kar loge. But can you do it for everything that you would like to explain? Not really. Can you do it? I mean, also it depends on, you know, can you do it with the statistical confidence that you have everything in your equation, right? And have enough data to be able to, you know, still make sense of that equation. So all of those questions, you know, kind of, you know, should lead you to a point where you say, okay, I will be able to estimate this equation, but with some kind of an error. So this error I can call E, or a lot of books would call it U. And it, this U is essentially for representation of uncertainty, or, you know, randomness. So this uncertainty or this randomness is coming from the fact that, you know, you can never define a perfect model. You know, somebody may be like, oh, you know, sugar could affect the price of sugar could affect, you know, the quantity demanded in two ways. It could, you know, could it be that, you know, it affects it, you know, so for example, I might be in a situation where I say, okay, initially quantity demanded for sugar, you know, you know the diminishing marginal utility law, right? So essentially that means that, you know, as your sugar increases, first the marginal utility increases, and then it, you know, at some point it reaches zero, and you know sorry, not an increase, it decreases, it reaches zero, and then it becomes negative, right? So this is your whatever DMU. But the diminishing marginal utility is the second you know order derivative, right? Now here, to be able to test this, so somebody might ask you, how will you test this in the model? You may be able to, you may not be able to, but the point is that, you know, because of the fact that there's an uncertainty inherently associated with the fact that you cannot get all the data and all the information for a particular, you know, dependent variable or independent variable into the model always, you allow for something called the uncertainty or the randomness or the error term, which essentially captures things that, you know, you haven't been able to capture in your data, but are still going to happen and still going to, you know, be driving the variation in Y. So the idea of an econometric model is to be, you know, explaining the variation in Y using the variation in X, and, you know, essentially be able to test economic theory using, by building a model and using, you know, statistical, using, I mean, techniques which would help you test, you know, hypotheses that, you know, are derived from theory and, you know, can be tested. So for example, here I would be wanting to test, you know, the law of demand. Does it even hold in the empirical, this thing, you know, discipline, empirical sense? And a lot of papers will tell you that it does. Like, you know, the very fact that it became a law means that it went through all of these, you know, wettings. So yeah, so I mean that's essentially the idea of this, you know, unit and the way it has worked so far. In the next you know video, I am actually not in the next video. I can probably talk about it here also. So you know, if you wanted to like broadly give a methodology for econometrics, the way you would do it is that, you know, you would have a statement or a theory or a hypothesis, then you would have a specification of the mathematical model for the theory, then you would have a specification of, you know, the econometric model. So, you know, just like I told you that here you have the diminishing marginal utility law, and you know the law of not the law, but you know, you could define a model where you are maximizing utility subject to a budget constraint. You could get quantity demanded as a function of, you know, P1, P2 and M. So that is the theory model behind, you know, the things that you want to do. So you have a, you know, you have a statement of theory or a hypothesis. You then have the specification of a mathematical model for theory. Then you have a specification of the statistical or the econometric model. Okay. Then you get the data. Then you estimate the parameters. Okay. And then you go for hypothesis testing. And then, you know, after that, forecasting or prediction and, you know, usage of model for policy purposes. So, you know, as fancy as that sounds, it's nothing. So like I said, the first step is your hypothesis, statement or theory. Second step is the mathematical model, which is to say the theory, it's also called a theoretical model. Let's just, you know, let's put it like that. The third step is your empirical model. The fourth step, and this is very important, obtaining the data. The fifth step is estimation of the parameters of the model. By the way, when I say parameters, I essentially mean, so in y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1, sorry, beta 1 x, beta naught and beta 1 are your parameters, right? So these are your parameters. This is your data. This is also your data, but you know, this is also something that you're trying to explain. So I mean, x and y you would have data on. So if you wanted to have an Excel sheet with data here, the data would look like y and x, right? And you would want to fit the y and x to this kind of a model, right? So so then you have the estimation of the parameters of the model, then you have hypothesis testing, then you have forecasting or prediction, right? And last is obviously using model for policy, right? We are a long ways away from that, but anyway, that's the point. Like, you know, any econometric exercise would go through these steps to kind of get to the end of it, right? Okay, so in your book, there is an example of the econometric model of consumption. My suggestion would be to kind of go over it once yourself. The idea here, again, as I have, you know, said multiple times, is not to, you know, so by the way, you know, there are also concepts of, you know, forecasting, prediction and hypothesis testing within this chapter in Gujarati, but those are not things that, you know, we are covering here. Those are things that will be covered in the next you know, portion of our syllabus, which is like unit 2. So those are things that we will be covering there, but the point is that this you know, example that you have in the book talks about, you know, exactly the things that I have talked about, but it's a different example. The reason I gave you an example which is different from the book is because I mean, I just felt like it. So, yeah, that's it. That's where I'm going to stop this video. See you next time, where we will be starting with the second unit. Thank you.